Welcome to the Kable Polygraph demonstration. I'm David Salz, president of Wireworld Kable Technology, and I'll be assisted by our national sales manager, Larry Smith. I'd like to ask everybody to silence their phones before we start. Our topic is testing cables for their preservation of music. And I'm going to begin with two questions for everyone. All else being equal, which has higher fidelity, a long cable or a short cable? And what has higher fidelity than a short cable? All right, so we're all agreed. And this answer is more than common sense. It's actually the only scientific reference standard for cable fidelity. This means we're literally listening to a perfect loss-free cable when we connect two components directly. My career in cable design began 35 years ago when I discovered that I could learn how to perfect cables by comparing them to direct connections. Before that, I found cable comparisons confusing. It certainly changed the sound, but I wanted to hear all of the sound, and I had no way of knowing what the cables were losing. When I switched to comparing cables to direct connections, I began learning how to create cables that let you hear and feel all of the music. Our demonstration system uses speakers that are triad CR2s, which we've modified by adding legs and amp stands. The inputs were already on the top. The source is a Bryston BDP1 playing 2496 files from a USB thumb drive into a Belcanto DAC 3.7. The mono amps are Belcanto reference 500 M's, and the system is powered by a Taurus line conditioner. We're using spade to banana adapters as the reference connections between the amp and speakers. To demonstrate the effectiveness of these tests, we're about to let you hear how generic speaker cables compare to the reference direct connections between amp and speaker. This test is fundamental to our industry because upgrade cables can only improve fidelity if generic cables degrade fidelity. We'll begin playing the reference direct connections, and then we'll play a 10-foot pair of 14-gauge zip cord. The third selection will be another 10-foot pair of 14-gauge zip cord, but with a positive and negative conductors split apart. And then we'll finish with the reference direct connections again. Thank you. first thing I learned from these tests is that the tonal coloration and dynamics of cables are controlled by the electromagnetic field that actually moves the signal through the cable. The split cable loses more music because the increased distance between the conductors weakens the field, making it less effective at moving the signal. Of course, what we really want is the strongest, most effective field so that all the musical details and dynamics can get through the cable. That is the goal of our patented DNA helix cable design. To demonstrate the effectiveness of the DNA helix conductor geometry, we'll now compare two Wireworld cables to the direct connection. First of those will be Mini Eclipse 7, which sells for $570, and the second, Eclipse 7, which sells for $1,800, and then we'll finish with the direct connection again. Minimizing the loss of music is the true goal of high-fidelity cables. However, cables can produce a wide range of sound effects, which some audiophiles use to adjust or spice up their sound. In testing, we found the most common effect of cables is added brightness in some portion of the upper mid-range to mid-treble. Depending upon where it appears in the spectrum, this effect can add mid-range presence or increase the apparent height and width of images. These colorations are caused by phase shift from the electromagnetic field. Above the bright region, cable sound rolled off. A similar effect takes place in the low frequency range, with most cables accentuating a portion of the mid-bass to upper bass in attenuating the lowest frequencies. This effect reduces pitch definition and dynamic expression, but it can sometimes add weight to the sound of a lean system. At best, tuning sound with Kable effects is a mixed bag that trades off purity and dynamics for effects that can sound impressive at first, but are likely to become tiresome over the long run. It's interesting that the sound of some speaker cables can change when they're lifted off the floor. What those changes mean is that the Kable is generating noise. It's very common for cables to be shielded from electromagnetic noise, but few are designed to avoid the noise created by static charges within the Kable. This is called triboelectric noise, and it's the reason that guitar cables can make noise through the amplifier when you touch them. It also turns out that the various colorations that we hear from Kable insulation materials are caused by differences in the noise they add to the music. My quest to eliminate that noise resulted in the development of Composite X2 insulation materials, which are much quieter than the Teflon we used in the past. Personally, I'd rather get shocked by a doorknob than let static charges interfere with my music. These comparisons are cited, but I've also done many double-blind tests since I developed and patented Kable comparators in the 90s. This interconnect comparator was the first of these devices. Double-blind testing of fine audio differences is very challenging because lots of repetition is required for statistical proof. The Motion Picture Experts Group, MPEG, are experts in this field. Their procedures involve finding the best listeners and training them to hear the specific types of degradation that they will hear and rate in comparison to a full resolution, you know, best possible signal. They also state that these procedures are necessary for positive test results, so it's safe to assume that double-blind tests of cables will need to be done equally well to succeed, and I'm working on that. We've also used recordings to create Kable comparisons. In 2002, we released a CD called the Kable Comparator Disc, which had a jazz song transferred through various cables and also direct. Considering the limitations of CD audio, it works very well. Recently, the German magazine Stereoplay produced an interconnect survey with 2496 files. They re-recorded a song through a group of cables and a direct connection. Those comparison tracks are available as free downloads. You'll find a link to them on our website and on the blue leaflets we're handing out here. We'll play short clips of three tracks now. First, the direct version, then AudioQuest Water, and then Wireworld Eclipse 7.
Dance over me. Thank you.
I've saved conductor materials for last because more conductive metals are like the icing on the Kable cake. They can improve the whole cake, but they can't fix anything inside. As better conductors reveal more music, they also magnify colorations caused by Kable geometry and insulation. This is also true for connectors, where more conductive metals can reveal more of the music. If you're seeking the ultimate in sonic purity, nothing competes with silver contacts and conductors in cables optimized for music reproduction. Hearing a dramatic difference between cables can be impressive, but the only thing it actually tells you is that one or both of the cables are very colored. Swapping cables cannot tell you how well either cable preserves music. To know that, you need to compare the sound with each cable to the sound with no cable, as we've done here. These comparisons tell us that the sonic changes caused by cables are a problem in music reproduction, not a solution. By designing cables to minimize audible changes, we maximize musical preservation, bringing you closer to the beauty and feeling of the original performance. Thank you for taking the time to participate in this demonstration. And I'm willing to answer a few questions, if anyone has. Yes?
If the cables change the sound,
If the cables change the sound in the treble area, you're saying probably around 1,000 hertz, 1,200, where would you say?
No, I'm saying anywhere, the common range that we tend to get in cables is upper mid-range to mid-treble.
Okay,
they can go beyond that, but that's just where most cables fall.
Okay, so let's say 1,200 hertz to maybe 4K?
Yeah.
Why can't you measure that frequency response-wise if it's actually changing?
Because it's a time-related effect. It's a time dispersion. So what happens is as we spread, this is especially true, you know, with high-frequency sounds, as we increase the duration of a transient sound, it automatically sounds louder to the ear, and that's what phase shift does. This is common with filters and equalizers and so on.
It would seem there's a way to measure that. I know in a speaker you can do a waterfall, time relationships and things like that. It's just surprised that there's
it absolutely corresponds to an electrical measurement, if that's what you're talking about. But in terms of having a measurement that really correlates to what we're hearing, I actually know people working on that. But at this point, I'm not sure that it exists. The phase shift relates to where the series impedance of the cable starts rising steeply, and that's where the cable shifts from predominantly resistive loss to predominantly electromagnetic loss. We call that the transition frequency. And that's usually, you know, where we hear the brightness and the accentuation, like a forward, present, mid-range, and so on. Yes?
Can you tell us how you're making a direct connection?
Connector is connected to both the amp and the speaker.
What is it?
It's a spade to banana adapter.
Okay, is it silver, copper?
Yeah, this is silver over OFC, but you know, any really tight connection makes a good bypass, you know, test.
Thank you.
Adapter. You're welcome. Anyone else? Well, once the cable is dialed in to sound as close to no loss and no coloration, we lock in those electrical parameters. So in other words, just the standard electrical parameters will tell us if the cable is on spec from that point forward, as long as materials don't change and so on. So the inductance and capacitance resistance is enough to just check the variation between cables. Occasionally people ask me and I send them the numbers, but we don't publish them because people don't have the tools to interpret them. Because it's very, you know, you'd have to develop those with the listening test. We can't just measure something and say what it's going to sound like, but if we listen to it compared to perfect, we know what's changed. Now, the impact of the changes will vary totally according to people's taste and their systems, and anything can happen in hi-fi. But if somebody's looking for the cable that passes the most music, this is the test that tells you that. Nothing else does. And I can tell you, once you start making these tests, and a lot of people can do it with speaker cables because there's a lot of mono amps out there, they're going to be surprised. Because some cables that are, you know, considered to be really good don't do well. They're, you know, it's flavor versus fidelity. Yes?
So how many times would you say you've given this demo right now?
Well, I've been testing cables this way for 35 years, and I've done various versions of this test. The first one I remember doing, I think, was in 1988, so there's really been a lot of them.
The reason I ask the question is that the amount of time that elapses from listening to a sample to you guys going up there and changing the cable, the memory forgets what the sound is. So if you had a way to change that.
You know, we've actually gotten really mixed feedback on this. Some of our best listeners like an interval equal to the 30 to 40 second track we use and find that preferable to a quick switch. You know, we have to use switching systems for the quick switches, and you know, switching and all of these things have loss. And so we do it both ways. I've got whole systems where everything's switchable and so on, but they don't have as good fidelity as plugging things in directly. Well, I guess that's it. If nobody else is, okay.
The recordings you can download off the website.
Well, various 1 meter interconnects. That was actually only a 1 meter interconnect.
Okay, so
Yeah, there were a total of 14 cables they used in the survey. There were a bunch of European brands, but there were some of the famous American brands there too, obviously. Yeah?
Have you tried doing listening tests with a bridged amplifier, which should cancel the magnetic field inside the cable?
Yeah, I mean, lots of tests. We never got any difference at all. In fact, that's one of the interesting things about this is people theorize that a lot of what people hear in cables and why the sound seems to be different in different systems has to do with electrical response interactions between source and load and all kinds of things. We've never been able to identify any of those changes. I can have a tube amp with a high impedance output driving an electrostatic speaker with a crazy load, and the way the cable reshapes the sound in a bypass test comes off pretty much the same as on this system. And what it loses tends to be about the same. Of course, you know, the interaction with the sound of the system, you know, like I said, could be anything. But what the cable does, we can define. Somebody else?
Come on back. Do you think we would come up with the same conclusion if we just assigned a number to each cable instead of saying this is this cable and this that's the thing? See, that, I mean, that's the scientific way to do it.
Oh, yeah. Well, we've really done a lot of blind tests, and I've actually been working on some techniques that I hope to present here. But at this point, we're not quite ready, and that's why, like I said, I'm working on it. But absolutely believe it, and have made progress. But always with the reference. Without the reference, you know, one loss versus another loss doesn't tell you. You know, what's missing in either cable. And what's missing is music. Yeah?
I'm really curious about your process, your design process. I mean, if you take a look at the cross sections of your cables, they're fairly complex. I mean, you have to construct that at some point, right, and try it. What's the process? Do you have a barrage with an infinite number of
Model making and fabrication are specialties I've been developing my whole life. I do them almost continuously. So, yeah, there's a lot of that.
So when you go after something as complex as that helix cable over there, what do you have in your mind? I mean, you must have some correlation between the characteristics.
Oh, I know. I've been studying the field for a long time, and basically what we're doing is channeling more of the field energy. And this follows all conventional physics. I've never learned anything that I couldn't trace down. A lot of things have been improperly identified in the high-end world. For instance, people think insulation material differences are primarily dielectric absorption. This is a minuscule effect compared to triboelectric noise. Absolutely minuscule. It's the noise we're hearing. Dielectric absorption is really small. So, you know, proving that and doing it fundamentally from the ground up using scientific method is how I learn these things, not just playing with this and that and, you know, thinking I'm done when I like the sound. I have a lot of taste. I do all kinds of things with sound for fun, but I think with cables, there needs to be an alternative out there where people can just get the most music through a cable, and that's why I did this. Yeah?
Conductors, I was just burning in some interconnects the other day, and I was wondering what your thoughts are on, from a materials science point of view, on conductors. When they're raw, they've never seen a signal, and after you push some signal through them, in.
Well, a number of things improve, including the triboelectric noise decreases as cables are burned in. And that's that harshness thing that people tend to hear. There's also something known as room temperature annealing that takes place in conductors, and signal accelerates that. So your metals are getting better, and your insulation's getting quieter as you break in a cable.
So the annealing is relaxing the stress.
Right. This happens with energy over time, you know, like I say, at room temperature. Because normally annealing's done at high temperature or cryo. Anyone else? Yeah.
Could you do the demo from the beginning again with the direct connection versus the 14-gauge separated zip wire?
I, if we have time. Yeah.
Thank you.
That's my job. Anyway, oh, yeah?
So the good folks from Audio Precision are here, and they're testing gear, one, two, heavy, I'm sure you've done this, but have you put any of your cables on as energy?
Oh, yeah, in fact, I'm in the middle of a bunch of tests, so.
What differences do you see?
Well, like I said, that parameter shift is the most fundamental thing, but there are really lots of things. I'm really working on some jitter, developing a good jitter test now, but the same magazine in Germany, Stereo Play, has already done it. Cables really affect jitter, and you can measure it. Thank you very much. Yeah.